first speaker is Manoj Durasinghe from Harvard Chan School of Public Health. She's going to talk about parasite egress from the red blood cells, and he has a very timely title, which is Escaping Lockdown, Early Signaling for Parasite Egress from Red Blood Cells. So please, Manoj, illustrate us on how to escape lockdown.
Thanks, Alfred, and thanks to the other organizers too, Sylvia and Sam. I assume everyone can hear me. Good morning from Boston, and it's great to participate in this very special BioMalPAR. And yes, so we will today talk about some of the work from our lab looking at how parasites get out of red blood cells. Gina covered this very beautifully just a second ago, but you know, malaria has been with us for a very, very long time, and it's we wait to see, you know, what disruptions in public health programs in endemic areas are going to do in the near future. But disease has been thought about for a very long time after it was first recognized that it was caused by infection of humans with Plasmodium parasites. But it was actually Golgi who realized that the symptoms of malaria were actually associated with intracellular parasites bursting out of red blood cells and entering new ones and leading to pretty high infections where when the parasite biomass gets really high, we end up with very severe disease. So all eukaryotes have a cell cycle where one becomes two, becomes four, becomes eight, very orchestrated in many different ways. And signaling is key to the accurate progression through these different phases. And but parasites, of course, do things in a slightly different way, and we need to be careful not to call it a cell cycle. In fact, it's an intra-erythrocytic developmental cycle that we normally deal with. We have a parasite, you know, can become several, then can actually during schizogony become very many. That actually differentiates into merozoites, which then leave the red blood cell and can enter new cells, and leading to those exponential infections and the huge parasite biomass that I mentioned a second ago. And so this is an exquisitely parasitic process, whereas this is much more conserved amongst all eukaryotes. And so today we're going to talk about one protein called PP1, but we have used a system. It was great to see Toby's very elegant genetic systems. This one is a bit dated now, but we do use it often, and it's one which allows us to assess the function of essential proteins. And you tag a protein in the presence of shield, and you take away shield, and that can lead to the degradation of the protein and hopefully revealing its function. And we've done this with many key proteins that we think power the Plasmodium parasite through its asexual IDC. And so we initially found a kinase involved in egress, a kinase and a phosphatase involved in the invasion of red blood cells. And more recently, we actually found a kinase that was involved in regulating the different rounds of replication that occur during schizogony. So today's story is really a wonderful collaboration between our lab and that of Dr. Mold Lamarck at the University of Montpellier. And in our lab, it really was Adi who did most of the work. And I have to say, I'm honestly not Adi, I'm actually Manoj, for those of you who know me and can see that I developed a very seasonal beard. But Adi has done extremely well. He's a research associate in the lab. And we noticed that from the great work of Dr. Rita Tiwari's group that PP1 was essential for blood stage proliferation, being one of many phosphatases that exist in the plasmodium genome. It's very highly conserved, and it's also one of the most highly expressed during schizogony. And in some systems, in fact, 50% of cellular dephosphorylation events are controlled by PP1 homologs. The way PP1 works is it's highly conserved, but it has these regulatory partner proteins, which actually take the complex to the sites of their action and lead to spatial and temporal diversity. In lower eukaryotes, there aren't actually very many of these regulatory proteins. There are only a couple. They seem to be very conserved, and they're involved in regulating the spindle assembly checkpoint. But they have been elaborated in higher eukaryotes, and there are many of these regulatory proteins that partner with PP1 to mediate many different functions. So using tried and tested destabilization domain system, we were able to elicit quite a decent knockdown, greater than 70%, and proliferation was wiped out. The parasites simply do not grow in continuous culture. And when you actually try and map when PP1 is actually functional, one of the advantages of the conditional protein expression systems like the destabilization domain is you can actually elicit depletion of the protein at different times during the cycle. So when we depleted it early, we actually found that there was a replication both in DNA replication and in nuclear division, and that's what you see here. This is also true when you actually elicit it right before the onset of S phase. You actually find, and I'll show you this in a second, that there, even though there's no effect on DNA replication, there is actually a significant defect in nuclear division. And this is true when if you elicit it, the knockdown, the depletion of PP1, a little bit later as well. However, when you elicit it right at the end, so at about 44 hours, what you actually find is that there is a complete block in egress, which is what is responsible for that complete proliferation defect, which is what you actually see here. So what we're doing is we've mapped the essential function of PP1 to a post-replicative process, which has to do with controlling egress. And when you look much more closely by electron microscopy, and these are wild-type parasites in the presence of shield and the absence of shield, the merozoites look almost the same. They look pretty much fully formed, and the numbers, as I showed you, are about the same. So, Malt Lamarck's lab, they were actually able to use a different approach, which was actually inducible knockout. So here, you use the system developed, the inducible Cre recombinant system developed by Mike Blackman's lab. And what you actually, and they were able to find exactly the same phenotype, which was one of blocked egress. And again, we wanted to know exactly where, by looking a little bit more closely than electron microscopy, these defects might lie. And what has already been known is that there's a well-characterized protease cascade that is responsible for eliciting the downstream steps of egress. But when we actually looked at many of the proteins involved in the processes of egress, the proteins were all localized to the right place. PVM rupture was essentially exactly the same and PFMA1 secretion and sub1 secretion were also exactly the same between wild type, and there essentially was none because the egress block was very much upstream. And so that's what I've, so the block in PFPP1 function led to a block in egress very much upstream of the protease cascade. So to find out exactly where that was, we decided to take a proteomic approach. And so we did proteomics and phosphoproteomics in collaboration with the Geigy lab. And Adi set up this this schema where we know that the block was right at the end of egress and of the ITC. And so by depleting PP1 right at the end, we took samples at 48 hours and 55 hours to try and control for cell cycle related changes as well. And the first thing is, by looking at the cell state by proteomics, you find that the two things that changed the most, the two proteins that changed the most, were those conserved regulatory subunits, which gave us some confidence in the specificity of what we were seeing. And so then when we looked at the phosphoproteomic changes using the same scheme, what you actually find was this, that in a cell cycle progression independent fashion, that there were two proteins that really stood out. One was HECT1, where there were huge changes in the level of phosphorylation, and this other protein, which is the phospholipid transporter guanylate cyclase alpha, huge protein. And so just to look at HECT, so HECT turns out to be the largest protein in the proteome. And there were actually inhibitors of the family that it belongs to. So it belongs to this HECT family, E3 ubiquitin ligase family. And HECLIN is a small molecule that seems to be able to inhibit most of the members of this family. So we took that and Adi sought to see how those parasites could be inhibited. And indeed, regardless of when you administer this drug, parasites arrested right prior to egress. Then to try and get a bit more specificity, he took a chemical genetic approach where he was hoping to see perturbation between levels of the PP1 knockdown and the ability of HECLIN to actually inhibit egress together. And so what you find here is, here you're depleting PP1 a little bit by reducing the amount of shield, and you see it's hugely sensitized to the actual HECLIN in terms of being able to inhibit egress. This suggests that HECLIN is indeed very specific for the HECT for the PP1 function. So what about guanylate cyclase? So this is this protein. It's a fusion of two proteins, the PLT and the guanylate cyclase. And guanylate cyclase's role is to produce cyclic GMP, which can then activate protein kinase G and elicit all of those downstream processes that lead to egress. And this can also be blocked by this molecule compound one. So in this case, interestingly, all the phosphorylation changes are actually in this big loop, not in guanylate cyclase, but in the PLT domain. So the first question was, what happens when you deplete PP1 and to cyclic GMP levels? And in fact, so you find a dramatic reduction in the level of cyclic GMP, suggesting that the inability to activate protein kinase G could be responsible for the block in egress following PP1 depletion. Then we looked at this other protein, PDE, which actually can take away cyclic GMP from the cell. And that can be blocked by this drug zaprenast. And again, a sensitization experiment was carried out with a very intriguing result. And when, again, you deplete PP1 a little bit to see if it can be further sensitized by zaprenast, you see this huge difference, over 400 fold sensitization in lower levels of PP1 to zaprenast. Now this is a little bit surprising because in this case you're actually depleting cGMP. Clearly cGMP metabolism is very relevant to PFPP1 function, but we do think that this may actually be evidence for a potential feedback loop, because it turns out PKG, the target of cGMP, actually shares that S674 substrate on PLT with PFPP1. So PFPP1 removes the phosphorylation from the site, while PFPKG is actually putting it on, providing the potential for a negative feedback loop. And then finally, we thought about this domain, which is predicted to be a phospholipid transporter. And great work from the Marty lab and others have shown that lipids play a key role in signaling in the middle of the IDC. But what we decided to do is to take several lipids that are thought to be bioactive and to see what would happen in the presence of PFPP1 knockdown. And in this case, you actually see that the administration of diacyl glycerol and phosphatidylcholine actually rescue the effect of the PFPP1 knockdown, and suggesting maybe that the ability to go through the PLT may be activating this protein, may potentially guanylate cyclase and cGMP production. What was also interesting is when phosphatidylcholine can actually get to the parasite itself, and that's very late in egress. It's actually in the last 5 minutes of egress that you actually start to see labeling of the parasite plasma membrane from exogenous fluorescent PC. So this gives us a nice model where PFPP1 has a role in schizogony, potentially conserved amongst all lower eukaryotes, but it's been co-opted to actually coordinate various signaling events right at the beginning of the egress process to coordinate all of the downstream processes. And I showed you some intrinsic signals that were being regulated by PFPP1, but even the administration of exogenous lipids can regulate egress, and we think that this may come from the red cell, either just prior to egress from the PVM, or even after egress. I went very quickly, but in fact, diacyl glycerol and phosphatidylcholine can actually rescue the defect of PFPP1 on invasion as well, and so this would indicate that the phosphatidylcholine could be active later to rescue the ability of a PFPP1 in terms of mediating invasion. So in summary, PFPP1 has a role in schizogony, but is absolutely essential for egress. It coordinates multiple signals early in egress. It's revealed a role for HEK-D3 ligase and potentially ubiquitination signaling in egress pathways. And certainly we think we have evidence that it regulates cyclic GMP levels through PLT GC-alpha. And so here's the lab. There's Adi again. And thanks again to Mold and Alexandra in her lab, who did a whole equal amount of work with the inducible knockouts. And thanks, of course, to our funders, and thanks to all of you globally listening in to this talk. And just to say, We're watching this meeting very carefully because we really hope to see you all in one form or the other in September at the molecular parasitology meeting. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Manoj, for an excellent talk. There are no questions so far. Let me check in my spam folder. Okay. I will start then. You mentioned that this is a gene, PFPP1, is a gene that is expressed at extremely high levels in schizons. I find it curious, is it common for proteins involved in signaling events during egress, or this is an exception?
For them to be very highly expressed, well, I mean, I think PFPP1 out of all the phosphatases is really the most highly expressed. There are a few others in very late schizons that from that picture I showed you very briefly are also very highly expressed. I think one of the key goals is going to be to see what PFPP1's regulatory partner is in late stage egress, if it is in fact unique to egress, because I think it's not really the level of expression that's so important, it's how the PFPP1 will be taken to its site of action. So it's the spatiotemporal regulation via its regulatory subunit that's really important. And so we're actively trying to identify the binding partners.
And do you know if PFPP1 plays a role at other stages or may play a role in the process of sexual commitment? Because the fact that it is linked with lipids is suggestive that it may have something to do with commitment. As you know, other lipids play a key role in this.
Yeah, so we looked at gametocyte conversion rate and didn't actually see a difference, but we haven't looked into it in great detail, to be honest, Alfred. So I suspect again it is likely to have a role throughout the life cycle, certainly a conserved role as in other lower eukaryotes in terms of regulating DNA replication. But the question of course remains, whether or not it's co-opted into other roles for going through the developmental cycles of the life cycle.
Okay, we have a question from Marcus Ganter. He's asking, what could be the advantage of integrating two signals, intrinsic and external?
Again, no, that is a good question. So the data was driven by our experiments. So we at some role, the reason for going further and further upstream in terms of egress is to try and understand what the triggers are for egress. And so in this case, the intrinsic signals could be, for instance, due to the levels of PFPP1 increasing to a point where it actually is then able to coordinate all of the different steps that are required. One of the reasons we're interested in the negative feedback loop is it could also be that once you get to a point where PFPKG is ready to go, you probably have to make sure that you haven't switched the egress program on until it's exactly the right time to leave, because the parasite has to have fully formed its merozoids to efficiently invade and finish its infection, and then the reason you have extrinsic signals could again either be to distinguish between being inside the cell and being outside the cell, so therefore potentially the merozoids are able to sense via the lipids that they're outside the cell, and therefore affect decent invasion. So I think it's to do with spatio-temporal regulation, both in terms of activation, but also to prevent premature activation as well. I can actually just show you one thing if I can, which I thought was quite curious. This is work from Brendan in the lab. So it's just about Babesia. And so Babesia grows in red blood cells, very closely related to Plasmodium, you know, about 100, only 120 million years apart, perhaps. And when he actually knocks down PKG in Babesia parasites, something very interesting happens. And that's this data here, if you can see it. The parasites divide, they just continue to divide, and they just continue to divide. It's almost as if there is really a link in these parasites, at least, between continuing with replication if the signals for egress are not actually initiated. And so so we thought this was actually quite fascinating. And we think one of the reasons, and this is actually probably why Plasmodium does it differently, is that Babesia parasites can actually egress at any time, or not for any time, but for most of its IDC, whereas Plasmodium really has to fully form its merozoites, and therefore you actually have that tight negative feedback loop, which is why you really have to respond to those multiple, coordinate those multiple signals all at once.
Okay. The next question from David Ross is in fact related with other epicomplexans. He's asking if Haeckelin inhibits egress in epicomplexans such as Cryptosporidium, Toxoplasma, Tellurium, or Babesia.
Honestly, we don't know. We haven't done those experiments. We haven't even done it with Babesia, which we probably should have done. But it'll definitely be something that we need to do going forward. When, you know, I think the comparative biology of egress is fascinating, because it is quite distinct for each of these parasites. So yes.
Okay, and we have time for one last quick question. It comes from Marta Machado. She's asking, what is the impact of PP1 on DNA replication? When you treat trophozoites, do you still see segmentation and egress?
I just show you the data very quickly. So what you get is, it really depends on when you deplete PFPP1. If you deplete it very early, we think you essentially get very poor nuclear division, and even DNA replication is reduced. But when you deplete it after the onset of schizogony, and you actually see something very different, where DNA replication seems to be almost complete, but the very last cycles of nuclear division are defective, and so that's actually what we see, and we haven't done the experiment where we've taken those ones, the mid stage induced depletions, and syringe release them to see if those merozoites are actually invasive, but they, by EM, they don't, they actually look pretty dysmorphic, and the last stage of nuclear division and merozoit formation is certainly compromised.
Okay, thank you very much, Manoj. We should move on. Please check the Slack channel, because there are several more questions for you. And the next speaker is Mathieu Brochet from the University of Geneva, also talking.